How are you, Ryan?
I'm really good. How are you doing?
I'm doing all right. I'm a lot better now. I'm talking to you because you sound like you're actually on top of the world, all things considered.
You know, it's weird what we're dealing with right now because it's so up and down emotionally, I think, for a lot of people. So some days, like today, I don't know, it feels like summer vacation.
Yeah. I guess the day's still early though, Ryan, right? That's it.
It is, yeah. It's like I just had lunch here.
You start on a good vibe, and then, yeah, I mean, first of all, if you don't mind me asking you about this first, mate, because ahead of all of this corona chaos, you know, you've had a pretty turbulent year, 18 months. Anyway.
Lord.
Do you mind going in on that with me for a little bit?
No, you know me, I'll talk about whatever. I don't understand why some people go, "Ooh, don't talk about that." It's like, especially in today's world, it's like, it's real life. It's something that actually happened. You can talk about it.
So you recently got divorced.
Yeah. And it's not anything I ever thought would happen to me in life. Like I really thought we were going to spend the rest of our lives together. And, you know, divorce is a special kind of pain. It's just, it's very, I don't know, it's very hard to explain because the legalities involved on top of the emotional part of it make it really hard because it's just, it's like all of the different stresses in life in one situation. Money stress, relationship stress, family stress. It's just, you know, it feels impossible at times, but I will forever have a, you know, special place in my heart for anybody that's been through it because it is brutal.
Have you seen the movie Marriage Story, mate?
That's really funny. That's really funny that you mentioned that because when all of this started, this virus situation, you know, everybody's talking about, what are you watching on Netflix? What are you, you know, do you have any recommendations? All of that. And my mom, of all people, was like, have you watched Marriage Story? And I go, Mom, what makes you think I want to watch a movie called Marriage Story right now? That's the last thing I want to watch right now, considering what I've been through. That's the other thing, Matt. Any sort of romantic comedy, any sort of movie like that after divorce
crushes you.
That's just one of a million different layers that you don't expect. Like I can't even watch those movies. I will again someday, but the TV shows or movies like that feel impossible.
Well, Marriage Story is a really interesting one because it deals head on with divorce and the effects of it and how those two individuals navigate those seas. And I've never been through that myself, but from an outsider's perspective, the way in which they deal with those themes is so moving and so touching and so blunt. And it's a really well-made piece of work. It might not be the time right now for you to see it, though. But but when you do get around to it, you'll appreciate it, man. And I will say this as well, mate, because I know that one thing you did do after you and Holly did, you know, split up is you basically got in a car and you just drove out into the wilderness and drove across America. Now, I bet you're so glad you did that now because, you know, now we can't go anywhere or do anything. And it seems like just at the right time, you got to squeeze in this beautiful, expansive, soul-searching adventure just before it was too late.
Yeah, I hadn't really thought about it like that, but that's a really good point. And little did I know that's the best thing I ever could have done. If anybody ever goes through it, I'm going to recommend that. Just go. Just go, you know, take that windshield time. And there's, it's different in America, you know, because it's so spread out here. But there are lots of places. There are lots of, you know, I didn't know there were apps on your phone that tell you cool free places to stay if you have an RV or, you know, I converted the band van into a little, you know, like a sleeping quarters and a mini kitchen. And there are lots of places to stay. Some of them are literally in the desert. Like I had run-ins with like a mountain lion, and I had my dog Peaches with me, and it's crazy, but I loved it, man. It was just the perfect distraction, and you're totally right. I really didn't think about the fact that I got in under the wire. I would have just been losing my mind dealing with that right now.
Tell me about, if you can, one night in particular which stands out, where you were in the middle of nowhere, you discovered some, you know, gem of a place, and you're lying there perhaps under the stars, you're going through all these thoughts and emotions that you are, and it sort of hits you all in one, like, this is a big, profound, special, crazy, magical, weird, once in a lifetime kind of a night. I bet you had quite a few like that, but does one stand out in particular somewhere where, you know, if you ever went back through that place again, it would just be an overwhelming surge of emotions?
Yeah, the one that sticks out to me is the first place I went is to the Big Bend National Park in Texas, and it's right on the border of Mexico. You could walk into Mexico if you wanted to, and there are mountains, and it's beautiful. And I went, and my dog Peaches, her name, was with me on this trip, but I get into Big Bend. There's no cell phone signal. I mean, it's the wilderness. It's for real. And I set up camp, have a tent, the whole deal. And I just kind of get ready for, you know, as much as I can plan for. I'm like, okay, I think I'm ready. I'm just going to stay here for like a week. And then I'll hit the road and see where else I'm going to go. So I get everything set up. I go kind of explore the first day, and then go to sleep, wake up the next day, and this is where it gets weird. I don't know if it was one day or a couple of days went by, but I'm there, I'm in my own head, I'm thinking about this divorce in my life and what is going on and what am I going to do, and I heard something, like another animal or something, and my dog Peaches growled. I was like, oh, that's kind of sketchy. But I told Peaches no. I said, no, Peaches. And as soon as that came out of my mouth, I realized that I hadn't said anything out loud for days. Wow. So and I was startled by the sound of my own voice. And that kind of quiet and that, you know, silence for whether it was one or two or three days, and I'm still not quite sure, the shock of the sound of my own voice. I'd never had that happen before, and I mean, I doubt I'll ever have that happen again like that, but just to have been in my own head, that kind of, you know, intense thinking, you know what I mean? It was really crazy, and it shook me, like, to the core, that moment, and I got really upset afterwards, and you cry a lot in the process of divorce, and I still have moments now where it sneaks up on you. But that's the one that sticks out, is that, like, you know, really getting scared by the sound of my own voice.
It's funny, I saw you wrote the other day that it hits you when you're having dinner a lot. That seems to be the one time, yes, when you'll be fine all day, and then you sit down to eat, and then all of a sudden it's like, there it is, that heaviness comes back.
It's weird, and I don't know if it's eating by myself, you know, when you're married, mealtime is, you know, that's something, you plan for it, what are we going to have for dinner or lunch or whatever, and are we going to go out, and a relationship, so much of it, and this is something I'm learning, is based around mealtime, and, you know, stupid stuff, even if you're an artist, and you don't really have that normal job, you still take a break to eat, right? And so there's still that, how was your day? Tell me what's been going on. You still have those moments, whatever your profession is. And now, yeah, it'll just come out of nowhere. I'll sit down to eat, I'm by myself, and boom, it's upsetting.
It's weird. I've never been married, but I broke up with my long-term girlfriend a few years ago, and I still get it now whenever I'm in airports. Because I haven't flown, with anyone other than her in like 7 years. Because I only flew with her when we were together and no one else. And then since we've broken up, I've only ever flown alone. So it's still now, like, whenever I'm in an airport, I'm still like, oh, I feel lonely now. It's like the only time in airports. It's fucking weird. So I know what you mean.
Isn't it crazy, Matt, how you don't realize how deep inside you, like how big of a part of your being certain things like that, like they're a part of you and you don't really notice it until that sort of situation happens.
And the person is long gone.
I know. You almost get angry, right? You're like, oh my God, I'm never going to be rid of this. But it makes us the people we are. I know there's a lot of cliche sayings like that, but a lot of it is very true.
Dude, let's break for your first of five songs as your soundtrack to the end of the world. The Rolling Stones, Far Away Eyes. I guess, you know, the task of just choosing five anyway was impossible, but especially with a band like the Stones, when there's so many, must have been incredibly difficult. Why this one?
This one just has that Texas country vibe. It's, and it references, you know, a lot of kind of Christian church, fake preacher, kind of evangelist. There's a lot of Texas in this song, and it's edgy lyrically, but it's also tongue in cheek. I don't know. It's my favorite Rolling Stones song, and I know it's kind of a random one to be my favorite, but it's probably because it's where the Stones and Texas kind of come together.
Sunday morning through Bakersfield, listening to gospel music on the colored radio station, and the preacher said, you know, you always have the Lord by your side. And I was so pleased to be informed of this that I ran 20 red lights in his honor. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. I had an arrangement to meet a girl, and I was kind of late. And I thought, by the time I got there, she'd be off with the nearest truck driver she could find. Much to my surprise, the little girl with far away eyes.
Is where you were living with Holly, is that still home, or did you get out of there and set up somewhere new? I'm assuming you're definitely still in Texas, but are you in the same place, or have you found a new home?
I have a new home. We both moved. We sold our old house. I started to try and stay there, but it felt really terrible, if I'm being honest. And getting divorced, if there's still a house there and it's part of it, it complicates it. So it was easier to sell it, and I was happy to get out of there
and start afresh.
Yes.
How's Texas right now with everything that's going on? What's the overall vibe and mood and tone in your community and your immediate area?
Dude, it's crazy in the South in America, and I've seen some stuff in the UK like this. There's a stubbornness in certain parts of the world. There's this attitude of, it's no big deal, it'll be fine. And Texas had some of that, and like, I live in the country, I live kind of out in the middle of nowhere, and everybody was kind of late to the, okay, we better take this seriously. Like, I wasn't, because I pay attention to kind of what's going on, and I knew that if government and celebrities and some of those, like Amazon, the wealthiest people in the world, if they are all on the same page, which never happens, all saying the same things, that people better pay attention. And Texas was weird, man. It was like there were pockets of small town Texas that didn't take it seriously, and they waited too long. And now, even though there was too much of a delay, and this happened a lot in America, now everybody's wearing the masks and the gloves at the grocery store, and everybody's staying home. The businesses are closed, but we waited a little too long where I'm from.
What's the vibe in terms of hospitals and cases and death tolls, dare I ask? Is Texas one of the states that's been hit hard? Does it seem to be under control? Like, are the hospitals coping with the numbers? Is it leveling out? Is it peaking? Like, what's going on with all of that side of things?
Sure. So, as I'm sure you've seen, like New York and LA, it's been crazy. California seems to have a better hold, but they're a little more spread out. New York is still crazy, but I think they're doing okay. Texas, not as bad as either one of those for sure. Texas is a huge state.
I guess social distancing is pretty easy in an area as big as the Lone Star State, right?
Exactly. So New York, I think that was part of the big problem. There's so many people in such close proximity.
Yeah.
But here, it hasn't gone nuts, like some of those numbers in those other states. But, it's definitely happening. It's definitely still spreading. We haven't flattened the curve here, but I think we're making progress. And it's just crazy, man. The more data we get, the more it's kind of like, okay, this is still something that we're trying to figure out. This is still going to take a little while. And the vibe here as far as the hospitals, we seem to have a pretty good handle on it. We're not as overwhelmed as some of the other states.
And what about your neighbors and your friends and people around you in your life? Like, are you interacting and engaging over the fence or from a safe, are you seeing people? Are you staying sane? What's going on?
Yeah, staying sane, who knows? But neighbors, there's more of a wave, like a long distance wave. Hey, there's not the walking up to each other and, going, what's been going on? The hardest part for me is, my family's here.
Are you isolating alone?
Yeah, so that's really difficult. I haven't had that interaction with another human, and as silly as it probably would have seemed to me a month ago, I miss like hugging someone or shaking someone's hand. I haven't had any physical contact with another human in over a month.
Yeah,
and just to hug my mom or dad or my grandma, and I haven't seen them, you know, other than video chat and stuff like that in weeks and weeks. And it's hard because you want to do the right thing. I don't know what I would do if my grandma accidentally, you know, got it because I had it and didn't know it and then passed it to my mom. And then my mom gave, you know how it goes. But it's hard, man. And there's a really weird thing. I'm sure you've experienced it where you see somebody you know and you both have that moment where you're like, well, I can't shake your hand or hug you and you better stay 6 feet away. You just kind of awkwardly look at each other and go, okay, bye.
Yeah, man. I mean, from your point of view as well, you come out of a really long-term relationship. So there's a definite sense of loneliness there anyway. And then to go from that to, oh, now actually you are now completely alone. And just as you say, like, you can see someone on the video screen on your phone, or you can hear their voice like we're doing now, and it's really nice, it's really reassuring, it keeps you connected, but there is no substitute for real life human interaction and like touch and sense. And as you say, whether it's just a handshake or a hug, it's tough, isn't it, man?
It is, and I have my moments where I think about what it's going to be like to give my family a hug or something, and my eyes fill up with tears, and that never would have happened 6 weeks ago, but just the thought of reconnecting with family or friends is almost overwhelming.
Yeah, I think it's keeping a lot of people going as well. It's definitely keeping me going.
Yeah.
That thought of the end of the line. I mean, when that will be, who knows? We'll come back. We'll talk some more about that in a bit. You had a great story with this man, which you shared on your Instagram or Facebook page, I believe. I wonder if you wouldn't mind sharing it now. Your second song is Tom Petty, Free Falling, one of my all-time favorite songs by anyone ever. And didn't you find out after he passed away that he'd heard your music or something and had appreciated it and liked what he heard? How did that go? What was the story?
Yeah, I'll try and tell the short version. So a friend of a friend was a driver. He was part of a company that drove artists whenever they were coming through Florida, I believe. Actually, just kind of all over the South. He would work for the car service and drive these people from the hotel to the venue. Or if there was a day off, he would drive them around, that sort of thing. So this guy was Tom Petty's driver, and they had gotten to know each other over the years. And this guy had really cool old cars the company did. So I think it was an old Cadillac with a bench seat in the front. And this guy's kid, I don't know how old the kid was actually, skipped school. Tom Petty had a day off, and they were going to drive Tom Petty around for the day. Tom asked if this guy would, he's like, can we just go, you know, drive around? I got some places I want to go. And of course, the guy said yes, and the guy's kid got to tag along, which had to have been cool. So they pull up to get Tom Petty. This guy and his kid are in the front seat, and Tom Petty got in the back, which I think is a really interesting detail in the story. And then, you know, they're driving around, and Tom Petty, like a little kid, is leaning up from the back seat into the front with his arms over the bench seat. And this kid has his phone or his iPod, whatever it is, plugged into the radio, just on shuffle, right? Nobody paying much attention to what music's being played in the car. And they're driving around looking at stuff. And Tom Petty isn't saying anything about any of the music. And then one of my songs comes on. This kid or his dad or somebody in that family, you know, had our music on there. And Tom stopped the conversation and went, hold on a second, who is this? I really like that. And, you know, that story made its way back to me after he passed, and I didn't know.
And how many tears of joy did you shed when you heard? I mean, that's got to be, I know how much as a songwriter and a human and an influence he was, you know, on the importance scale to you. That must have been so great and validating and inspiring to hear that story. Heartbreaking in a good, in the best possible way.
Yeah, and dude, even now, like even telling it and you know, I've told that story a bunch, but I feel myself trying to hurry the story because I still get emotional. It's like, oh God, hurry up, spit it out, or I'm going to cry.
Hold back the tears. Hold back the tears.
She's a good girl, loves her mom, loves Jesus in America too. She's a good girl, is crazy about Elvis, loves horses and her boyfriend too. And it's a long day living in Reseda. There's a freeway running through the yard, and I'm a bad boy, 'cause I don't even miss her. I'm a bad boy for breaking her heart. The vampires walking through the valley move west down Ventura Boulevard, and all the bad boys are standing in the shadow, and the good girls are home with broken hearts.
So, dude, what were you working on in the lead up to this event, and what did you have in the diary that you've had to pull or postpone or cancel? How's your work schedule for 2020 changed in the last few weeks?
You know, Matt, it's brutal for us because, you know, I've had almost big success twice in this business, and we kind of started over about 5 years ago, and it's all been happening and fast forward with this band and being on Stevie Van Zandt's Wicked Cool Records and all of this, it's all very exciting. And this year was our first year that we were supposed to play music festivals in the UK.
Great.
And then next year, it looked like it was going to be bumping up to the bigger ones, Isle of Wight, you know, maybe Leeds and Reading and some of those bigger ones. Well, we're not getting to do any of them. And, you know, being a kid from Texas and seeing the video footage in the 90s of these festivals and these seas, you know, the sea of people with their people have flags, you know, that image that like, oh my God, look at all these people at these festivals. I've always wanted to do that. And we were finally like in, like we were going to do it. And none of it's happening. We had tours booked around, you know, this summer's festivals that all got canceled. And this was going to be kind of a celebration of 5 years of hard work. And we finally got to this place that we wanted to get to. And now it just all kind of went away until next year, like for an entire year. It's nuts. Financially devastating too. And I know I'm not the only one. Like there are lots of people. I think about guys like our friend Frank Turner, who are on the road constantly, and they have mouths to feed and crew and band and whatever. And dude, it's brutal.
Do you feel in your heart that the work that you've put in over the last 5 years and the place that you've managed to get to will still be there next year? Like, do you feel like it's just been put on hold as opposed to that victory lap is now beyond you?
No, I feel good about it. We actually, the ultimate irony of all of this is we just finished a new album.
Dude, you're relentless with the albums. I love it. I don't think I've ever met anyone as prolific and productive as you. Like, you do an album every single year, don't you? Without fail, pretty much.
I have for the past five and, you know, this, well, I should say past four or five. But I wasn't going to do another one. Like, our album, This Is the Sound, still, it just got nominated for Album and Song of the Year and the Independent Music Awards and, you know, that album is still doing great. Well, then, you know, my marriage ended and I went on that road trip. And of course I brought a guitar just in case. And after that road trip, I came home and I had all of these songs, you know, that would not have existed without my marriage ending. And, you know, Stevie has been amazing. He's helped me through all of this. He's been huge, kind of crafting these songs into really, you know, next level stuff. And it would have been real easy for me to just leave them all sad bastard sounding, you know.
I was gonna say how devastatingly somber were these songs? Were they hardcore?
There were so many. Yes, there were so many. And to kind of sift through them all and find the ones that were like, okay, that's a really great song just as a song, no matter what you've been through. And now to have that, and you know, it's also kept me sane. I have to say, having that to work on has not only been therapeutic, but it's been exciting, and it's kept me from feeling, to get back to your question, it's kept me from feeling like the bottom was going to fall out, because it's like, okay, we're not doing the festivals. We had to cancel two tours. We still don't know if we're going to be able to do a big Christmas show or a few of them at the end of the year. We don't know. But we have this album, and it'll probably come out in the fall. So that'll keep us going.
Well, you know what? I think that times like these is when people like me and you, well, everybody really, but particularly the people that aren't comfortable, have to think outside the box, have to get creative and hustle. And I think you've always been pretty good at adapting and trying to figure out, okay, well, that road in front of me is blocked. Let's find an alternative route and get around. And I think it's a good test, like times like this. It's not a welcome one, but it's here and it ain't going anywhere. So I think it's, you know, a very good and opportune time for people to say, okay, how can I figure this out? How can I make my way through it? How can I earn a living? How can I think on my feet and you know, conjure up what I need to get by? And that, for me, is an exciting prospect.
Right.
If I can twist it in that way.
Absolutely. And I'm going to forget the saying, but there's a saying that's something like, you know, you can either lay down and die or get up and, you know, make it happen. And you know this, just reference that we're both like that. There's something extra motivating about the hustle and, you know, it being your livelihood. It's like, okay, well, I don't really have a choice.
Yeah.
So I have to find a way through this. I don't have Coldplay money. You know?
Yeah.
And it's also that thing where you feel grateful to still be able to do it, right? So at least we get to do this, and this is our life, and we get to do what we love. But it does not make times like what we're dealing with right now very easy. But we always find a way, and I think you are evidence of that, and I'll put myself on that list too, that you can figure it out if you have the hustle and the drive, and, you know, there's a way. There's always a way through.
Yeah, and I honestly think, without being too mean or cutthroat, if you can't find a way, then you're maybe in the wrong business.
I agree.
Because it's a tough one, man. It'll chew you up and it'll spit you out, and unless you're prepared to roll with those punches, then maybe it is, you know, time to segue into a career that offers, well, I say that though, but, you know, even stable jobs right now don't offer security. That's what's so wild about this situation,
right,
that we're in, is traditionally the 9-to-5 guy would always be okay. And now even they're not.
Yeah.
That's what's so wild about it, isn't it?
I know. And, you know, people doing these online shows and trying to bridge the gap. Now we have to be wary of what you're saying. It's like, okay, look, yes, all of our tours got canceled. We still have bills to pay, so we're doing these shows. But we know you may be out of work too, so we'll make these shows, pay what you can, or we'll play and you can watch for free. And if you want to donate, here's a link. So there's kind of been this balance because people are conscious of the 9-to-5ers not having the income they had before. Some people are fine. Some people still have, you know, that income coming in because of what they do for a living. But there's so many just regular jobs that went away, and we can't expect people to, you know, buy a ticket to whatever, an online show, or, you know, it's unbelievable. We're going to look back on this when we're old and go, holy shit, we lived through coronavirus.
Mm-hmm.
We were alive when that happened.
Yeah, it's a game changer, man. It's a very significant moment in human history that will, you know, forever be looked back on as a chaotic time in our lives. Third song on the list, dude, is Robert Zimmerman. And we've gone with a bootleg live version of Just Like a Woman. Interesting song, interesting variation on the song. How come you wanted the bootleg version of this particular track?
So that version, there's a certain ache in it. It's just more of a somber version. The studio version, I mean, it's a classic song, but the studio version, as much as I love it, it's kind of like, oh, well, that's kind of funny, that the way it the line is delivered, you know.
It's blasé.
But that, yes. So the live version, it's just, I don't know, it tugs at my heart for whatever reason, that particular performance. And I just love it. It's my favorite version of that song. It's one of my favorite Dylan songs. And I know he's a hero of yours, too. And there's a certain magic that happened in the 60s with Bob Dylan. And this song, for me, in this performance of it, has that magic, that 60s, mid-late 60s Dylan magic.
For me, it's all about, I guess it was in the space of 18 months as well. He did Bringing It All Back Home, Highway 61, Blonde on Blonde. Like, those three albums in less than 2 years in succession, forget about it. If he'd have only just made those three, that would be enough to cement him as my all-time favorite. Like, outrageous levels of talent.
Yeah, I know. It's and the leap from the first record.
Yeah.
It's nuts. It's so, so crazy. And that's why people talk about, you know, the deal that he made at the crossroads, and because how could he possibly have done that level of work, you know, without selling his soul to the devil?
Yeah, well, then when he had the bike crash as well, like after Blonde on Blonde, and then you see, you know, John Wesley Harding next, like, and he goes sort of Nashville skyline, and, you know, Blonde on Blood on the Tracks is obviously a great album, but you can see he's notably knocked back in his tracks, isn't he? Like, as if some outside source and power had to go, slow down, chill out. Like, you've gone off the rails, son.
Like a woman,
Yes, you do, and then you ache just like a woman. But you break just like a little girl.
It's interesting, dude, as well, because you've just picked out as the first three there, Rolling Stones, Tom Petty, Bob Dylan, all contemporaries and peers of a guy who is now, you know, a mentor and a friend and somebody that's actively involved in your life and your career. You mentioned him a couple of times, but we haven't properly spoken about him. And since me and you really properly spoke on, you know, a microphone, a podcast, whatever, Wicked Cool wasn't in the picture then. Stephen Van Zandt wasn't in the picture then. So let's chat about that. How did he discover and become aware of what you were doing? How did that meeting first come about? And then tell me about how signing with that label and working with him has impacted and changed and, you know, indeed, no doubt, improved the course and the trajectory of your career.
Yeah, so the story goes like this. Ginger Wildheart and I did a song together called Fuck You Brain. It was a charity single. We donated all the proceeds to Samaritans in the UK. We raised a ton of money. And Little Steven's Underground Garage wanted to play that song. They wanted a radio edit of that song. So they added the song to rotation. And then apparently Stevie went, this song is great. Who's that guy talking about me? It's like, I want to hear more of whoever this is. Who's this guy? So I get this email that says, Little Steven is interested in playing your stuff on the radio. Do you have a link to an album or whatever? So I sent the album that we had at the time. Then I get another email that says, we're adding half of the record to the rotation. It's like, is somebody fucking with me? Like, what is going on? So Stevie heard an album called The Devil's in the Detail and added six songs from that record into heavy rotation.
Nuts.
On his radio station. Yeah, you know how unheard of that is.
Yeah. So even for, like, you know, a huge artist.
Yes.
Even if you're the Red Hot Chili Peppers, like, to have album, that's wild.
It was nuts. So that's how it started. And then we were on tour in the UK. They didn't know that the label we were releasing music under was our own label. It was just us self-releasing. We called it, you know, our whatever our label was. And once they found out, I got an email from the guy that runs Wicked Cool with Stevie. It said, hey, would you be interested? We'd love to do a release with you. It's like, are you kidding? I would love that. So then I finally get on the phone with the man himself. And it was very funny because I could tell, and knowing him the way I know him now, it's really funny. When I spoke to him, I kept calling him Mr. Van Zandt. It's just because, you know, I'm from the South and it's the way I was raised. And
yeah.
So, you know, yes, Mr. Van Zandt. Oh my God. Thank you, Mr. Van Zandt. And I could feel some tension on the phone, and he finally kind of cut me off, and he goes, "Ryan, Stevie is fine." I was like, okay, I was over Mr. Van Zanting the conversation. and he kind of, he laughed, and I laughed, and in that moment, it just became very loose, and you've met him. He's such a cool guy, and he can be super down to earth. He's easy to talk to, and
just an encyclopedia of music. Like, he's a real historian, isn't he?
Dude, it's so nuts, the depth, just kind of the wealth of knowledge. And he asked me one time, he said, "I don't know if you're religious or if you go to church." And I said, "Well, I used to be, and I was raised that way, but I don't really go anymore." I said, "I guess my church is music." And he came back at me and goes, "Well, we go to the same church then."
Nice.
And I was, yeah, and it's, you know, he's all about it. He's in 100%. And working with him has become more of just he runs the label. He's become a mentor to me and a friend, and been lucky enough to spend a lot of time with him and his wife in New York. And I mean, shit, we've co-written like 4 or 5 songs together now. And there's like consistent pinch me moments because he's so far up the music business totem pole, if you will.
Yeah, yeah.
You know,
well, dude, he's Springsteen's right-hand guy and has been for over 3 decades.
Right, and he, not to mention The Sopranos and Lilyhammer and that sort of thing, he's a certain level of famous. And I don't know, working with him, and other people will say this too, that part of it kind of goes away because, you know, he has no tolerance for bullshit, I'll say that. And I've been cursed at and, you know, told no, and, you know, in a very Italian New York, Silvio kind of a way. And it comes from a place of love and out of belief in what you're doing. But, you know, I've heard stories of other people not knowing how to deal with that sort of, like, you know, that's fucking stupid, or I hate that, or, you know, don't do that. And
well, I gather he's that way with Bruce as well, and that's why Bruce has kept him around as long as he has, because he's that's not good enough. That's not going to do. That's not going to cut it.
I know. And, man, I'm so thankful. And if it wasn't, I always try and remember, you know, the reason. If it wasn't for Ginger believing in me and wanting to work together and us doing that one song together, then I wouldn't be where I'm at with Stevie now and on this great label, and all these amazing things have happened and continue to happen. And very lucky, very thankful.
All, you know, great people who I've had the pleasure of having on my show as well. Like, it's a cool little spider diagram. Yourself, Stevie, Ginger. I know you got to play some shows with Jesse Malin as well recently, and you two should definitely, when the world's allowed to, you know, move around a bit more, you should definitely link up and write some songs with Jesse, man, because there's a similar sensibility, particularly with, I don't know whether you heard one of the last tracks he put out called Meet Me at the End of the World.
Mm, yes.
That's got a proper Ryan Hamilton kind of a thing to it. And
you know,
I think you two would really hit it off if you got in the room and started writing some songs together.
I think so too, and it's funny because
And he's Stephen's boy as well, isn't he? Like, he does a show on his radio station. I think they go way back. And
yeah, well, that last release, Sunset Kids, came out on Wicked Cool Records.
There you go.
That song in particular, Stevie, I remember him and some of the other Wicked Cool folks mentioning it. And then, you know, Jesse and I did this thing in New York, and we've kind of struck up a friendship. And I would love it. I mean, he's got that thing, right, where he has the underground cred, and then he also has the success, but it's never been the big, you know, huge stadium success, but a very respectable, like, okay, that's cool. He can kind of sell out the big club venues all over the world.
Yeah.
And he's got that thing that he's at the place I've always wanted to be. And you know, I'm a fan of his, and we almost did a new song together, and then this virus kind of happened, and Stevie kind of took the lead with it, but I can totally see us working together. I can totally see us touring together. We had a blast last time we played together in New York, and another really great dude. Just, he's all about, you know, the positive mental attitude, and just kind of, you know, humble and, but still confident. Stevie's got that too, that humble confidence. So maybe it's a New York thing.
I think so. Yeah, as you said earlier, they're not taking any shit, but they're not asshole arrogant with it.
Exactly.
Well, it seems like you finally found your home, man. It's taken a while, but it seems like you're there in the pocket. And, you know, obviously there's a pause on things at the moment because of everything that's going on, but it sounds like you're in a good spot, dude, in the professional sense.
I am, yeah. It's better than it's ever been. You look at the things people look at now, you know, Spotify streams and stuff like that. The numbers, everything's bigger and better than it's ever been. And it's funny how it's worked out, but I'm very happy, very thankful, especially considering the dumpster fire that my personal life has been. So, so it feels good.
Hey, man, you got to have the trade-off somewhere. So, mate, this next song you're going to play, a band I'm only really familiar with because of their hit single, Semi-Charm Life, Shame on Me. But even recently, I just found out that although that's a very happy-go-lucky, catchy kind of emo pop song, it's actually about, like, you know, a meth addict, right? Like a speed addiction. Semi-Charm Life by, of course, Third Eye Blind. You haven't gone with that song. You've gone with Motorcycle Drive-By. Tell me about this band and what they perhaps, you know, signify and mean to you, and then this song in particular and the, you know, the personal connection there.
So this song and this era of music always makes me think of, you know, being a teenager, and I think people always gravitate to that part of their life with certain, you know, that's when music hits you in your teenage years, and the stuff that you love, you really love it, like you're all about it. So for me, it was starting with Semi-Charmed Life and then buying this record, and I played that album so much, that CD so much, I had to go buy another copy because I wore it out. And it's one of a few from the mid to late 90s that happened with. And for me, it was the first time, not only is he a brilliant lyricist and the choices he makes melody-wise, it's just, he's a genius in that way. But it was the first time I felt like poetry met pop music in the way that it does with Third Eye Blind. And Motorcycle Drive-By, that, and there's another song called God of Wine on that record, and they're right at the end. In the 90s, they used to do that thing where they would just kind of like boom, 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 right at the end of a record, like three really intense, sad, slow songs, and I used to love that. And they did that, and this song in particular, it's just poetic, and it's beautiful. The way he puts the words together, this was one of those, I used to smoke cigarettes, I don't anymore. But I remember very vividly driving around, smoking a cigarette, listening to this song just on repeat. I would listen to it over and over and over. And it was just like I was in a trance when this song would come on. I don't really know why. There's just something magic about it for me. And if you ever go to one of their shows and they play this song, it wasn't a hit song and it was never on the radio, but everyone in the crowd will sing every word.
Summertime and the wind is blowing outside, and though it's Chelsea and I don't know what I'm doing in the city, the sun is always in my eyes. It crashes through the windows and I'm sleeping on the couch. When I came to visit you, that's when I knew that I could never have you. I knew that before you did. Still I'm the one who's stupid. is this burning like there's always been? I've never been so alone, and I've never been so alive. This is a view on a motorcycle drive by. The cigarette ash flies in your eyes, and you don't mind. You smile and say the world, it doesn't fit with you. I don't believe you, you're so serene. Careening through the universe, your axis on until you're guiltless and free. I hope you take a piece of me with you. And there's things I would like to do that you don't believe in. I would like to build something, but you never see it happen. And it is burning like there's always been.
One good thing to come out of this lockdown for me is finally, after 100 failed attempts and 20 years of smoking, I mean, it's still early days, but I'm currently on day 16 of no cigarettes.
Way to go.
No nicotine, and it feels good, man. It's the one good thing to come out of it for my body.
That's great. Did your taste buds come back? That's what I noticed when I quit. I was like, holy shit, food tastes better.
Not only the taste buds, dude, the fucking appetite. I'm eating like a pig. I'm having about 8 meals a day, and because I'm just sat indoors all day, I'm going to be a right fat bastard by the end of this. But
we're all going to be so fat. Quarantine diet.
And the other thing, which, you know, and I'm sure you'll be in the same boat here, like, this is the worst time in human history to be single. Because, you know, when we're going to be able to actually go out and meet people to, you know, vibe off and chat up and flirt with and ask out, who knows when that's going to be. And I don't do the apps and any of that stuff. I refuse to do it because I'm old school. I like to meet people in person and vibe off them.
Yes.
But so there's just like, there's not even a blink in the distant horizon of when that will next be, you know, a viable option again. So... yeah, it's a pretty shitty time to be single, right?
It is. And so far, and I hope you can say the same, so far I haven't fallen down the late night, like, bottle of wine Facebook dive, the deep Facebook dive into ex-girlfriends or somebody you wanted to ask out a long time ago. And I feel like I'm doing okay as long as I don't go down that. Now I wonder what so-and-so
yeah,
is
right.
doing.
It's funny though, because I imagine a lot of people who are in relationships now and are living together with their spouse 24/7, the flip side is I imagine a lot of people are probably being driven up the wall by their partners, and I reckon your little divorced club is going to be a lot bigger by the end of this lockdown, right?
You're probably right.
You can see it happening. So you have to look at it like that, like it's a double-edged sword. Like, yeah, it sucks being alone, but I guess it's better than being with someone that you really don't want to be with all the time.
Yep, you have a point.
It's such a weird one, man. Like, there's so many other little adjustments and things that I'm thinking of. What I'm doing for the first time maybe in my life at the moment is actually just being like a Monday to Friday kind of regular work guy. So because I've always been either like a bartender or a DJ or a radio presenter or whatever, I've never had a lifestyle where I live for the weekend. But what I'm doing at the moment is I'm just working all week and like staying pretty sensible and trying to stay off for the large part alcohol in the week. And then when it gets to Friday, I'm like, party. And I'm now like a live for the weekend guy, like the fucking city banker.
Yeah. It's got to be kind of fun since we're all stuck. It's like, you know what? I'm going to create my own routine from home.
That's
and
it.
And then Friday, the and week's over.
You got something to live for then. You got something to look
That's
forward
really
to.
Great.
How are you treating yourself? Like, how are you rewarding yourself? What sort of habitual things are you trying to either avoid or fall into to stay healthy and happy? Like, what tips could you share with people that have been keeping you on the straight and narrow?
Okay, this is going to be super embarrassing, but I'm going to tell you anyway.
Go for it. Please do.
The only people that know that I'm doing this are like my manager and my parents. So.
And now everyone.
And now everyone else. Here's what I've started doing. So I have on the big TV, like in my living room, I have YouTube TV. I don't know if you have this. So YouTube TV is great. You could probably just use YouTube to do it. Well, you can dial up pretty much a ton of concerts from way back in the day all the way up till now. And you can just search full concert, right? Whatever the band is, full concert. And there is a plethora to choose from. So what I do, so I find a concert. It's really been stuff from my youth, like embarrassing stuff from the 90s, like some Pearl Jam from 96, kind of a thing. So I'll get drinks. I'll get it all set up just like I'm going to the show.
Yeah, yeah.
Right? I'll have a drink in hand. I'll go into my living room. I turn the lights off. So the only thing that's there is the TV, is the concert. And I'll stand there and I'll press play. And I'll watch it just like I'm there, like I'm at the concert. I got the surround sound on, and I blast that shit and get drunk.
Genius.
And, dude, I have the best time. And there's like,
you know, I love it, man.
I didn't get to go to Lollapalooza in 1997 and wherever, but I've fucking been there now, you know? And it feels odd, but it's also really fun. And then it's like, okay, there's a start and an end. There's not the sad, you know, I'm going to get drunk by myself and I don't know when I'm going to go to bed. It's like, okay, the concert's over. I had my drinks. I had a great time. I'm done.
You don't treat yourself some merch on the way out? Something to remember the night by?
It's really funny because I do. I get online and I'm like, you know what? Fuck it. I'm going to buy an Our Lady Peace t-shirt.
Yeah. Amazing.
Whatever band it is. Yeah.
Dude, that sounds like a great idea. Like what me and my friends did, we haven't done it yet since the first time. We were meant to be doing it more regularly than we have, but we've been sitting around on Zoom doing video conference, like table reads of famous scripts. So we did Reservoir Dogs. everybody has a role, and we just sat around. And that was a similar sort of thing, just like make-believe, childlike stuff that you'd never usually do if you're allowed to go out. But now, because we're not, it's like, okay, we need to create fun. And, dude, I love that. YouTube concerts at home. That's wicked.
Super fun. I love your idea. That would be great. Get a group of four or five people and go through it. How fun.
Get the table reads. Go, well, we can trade each other's ideas right off right there. You have the table read. I'll have the home concert. That's going to be my new Friday night jam.
Dude, I have to say, I've been amazed at the number of full concerts you can find from the 70s all the way up till now. It's really crazy.
Well, Lollapalooza, I have never seen any footage from any of those. And that's such a special time in music when you had such a varied mix of hip-hop and alternative rock and metal. And yeah, that's definitely a rabbit hole I'm going to go down. The fucking
enjoy
90s traveling festival chaos. Ryan, thank you so much for taking the time to share your, you know, your lows and your highs and your life, as you always do. It's always a treat talking to you. And yeah, thank you for brightening up my day, mate. It's been great.
Dude, my pleasure. And I think that it's more important than ever for people to communicate right now. And I was really happy when you reached out, and God knows how long this is going to last, but I relish any opportunity, and I hope other people do the same, just to communicate and talk and, you know, stay connected in whatever way that we can.
Yeah, man. Well, I'll definitely touch base again, I'm sure, before we are unleashed back out into the wilds, because, I mean, it's not going to be for a while, is it, man? There's not going to be any summer festivals. I can't see any happening. That's the grim reality, I feel like. But, you know, when they do come back, imagine how good those shows are going to be for both the performers and the punters.
I know. I cannot wait.
The fifth and final song, I've never even heard of these guys. I didn't want to do any investigation. I just wanted to get the introduction and the setup from you.
God.
Splendor with Yeah Whatever. We're going to play out with these guys. What's the deal?
Okay. This is, everybody has that band from back in the day, they're like, they should have been huge. They were one of my favorites, but they never quite, for whatever reason, broke through. This was that band for me. I can still listen to that record, start to finish, and love every minute of it. I saw them at a thing called Edgefest in Dallas, Texas in 1999. They had this song that I sent you on the radio at the time. And they just kind of went away and never did anything again. And it's one of my all-time favorite records, one of my all-time favorite songs. And they're a band a lot of people won't know. And I think it's just a shame. It's such a great song and such a great record. And anytime people ask for, like, your Desert Island Discs or whatever, I always put them on there.
Killer. Nice one, dude. Well, thank you. Thank you for the introduction. Thank you for the great chats, and thank you for the great tracks.
Man, my pleasure. Always great to talk to you, whether it's recorded or not.